means that the dissolution rate is going to be increased. Plus the fact that if you get your conditions right, you can get the drug to be molecularly dispersed in the polymer, which means you have no crystal lattice to break down. So if you've got this incredibly strong crystal lattice, which is a real barrier to dissolution, that problem's just gone away. So this is a very interesting way of approaching the whole idea of pore water solubility. But also the joy of it is that you can actually produce things on a large scale. There is no point in producing anything for oral administration on a small scale. By definition, you have to be able to produce kilograms of the material at the very least, which we can do with this technique. So the next technique that I'm going to talk about, I have no excuse for not knowing what we've actually plagiarized and stolen to make what we're rather pompously calling centrifugal spinning nanofiber generation, but it goes by another name. I'll explain what I mean in a minute. But basically what you have is you have a metal plate with a spinneret. So this is basically a, you guessed it, which is basically a spinneret here, which is basically a cylinder which spins around very, very rapidly. And you place your materials, such as, for example, sucrose, into the spinneret. This spins very, very rapidly. This heats, and your fibers come out very, very rapidly. Here, it's air-cooled, and you end up with these fibers. Okay? So, let's hope that I can get this to work. This only lasts for 30 seconds, so don't think you can.
Bioavailability, because we need to reduce the dose of
So what we're hoping is that we can take these sugar fibres and put them into conventional tablets and use those conventional tablets as mini tablets. And literally over the road from us, we have Great Ormond Street Hospital, which is one of the great children's hospitals, where funded by the copyright Peter Pan, as you may be aware, but also the Institute of Child Health immediately next to that. And we're collaborating with them to see whether we can actually develop this as an idea. And the good news is we have managed to make tablets out of these fibres really rather easily, to my enormous surprise. I thought that would take months, but it worked out very well. So this is going in a very good direction. Also staying with the fibres as well, but I'd like to move away from the oral route, is we're collaborating with the Institute of Women's Health within UCL. And this really came from an idea when I had a chance meeting with Peter Brocklehurst, who's the head of that department. And I was sort of saying we're looking for imaginative solutions using formulation science for clinical problems. And he was, I didn't realise, I must admit before I got onto this area, just how big a problem preterm birth is. And it's one of the major causes of death for neonates, but also sadly for mothers as well. And basically, even in the US, with all the facilities that they have, it complicates something like 12% of all deliveries and accounts for 85% of perinatal morbidity and mortality. So it's a major, major, but somewhat unsung problem that Peter, being a clinical trial specialist, is very keen that, that we address. And it's a global problem as well. So, what can we do about it? Well, drug therapy is not terribly well developed. And one of the things that's very sad about any drug that's used to be administered to pregnant women has an automatic problem as far as the industry is concerned, because the regulation is so tight. The patient group, although it's huge, is transient, because obviously you won't stay pregnant for a certain period of time, and that puts an economic pressure on. And I think, frankly, after thalidomide, the pharmaceutical industry is terrified of going anywhere near drugs associated with pregnancy, which of course means that one of the major causes of death for both women and babies is actually not being properly addressed. So the good news is that it does appear that good old-fashioned and very familiar progesterone is actually really rather effective in this regard. So the FDA have approved the administration of progesterone to women who are considered to be at risk of preterm birth. And so that then, and particularly for the phenomenon of cervical shortening, which is one of the main causes of early birth. Now, the problem is, how do you actually deliver this? And again, this has not been a great success story, so people have been looking at using suppositories and various gels, etc. But all the reports are that these are quite unsuccessful. So our idea was, could we actually make a nanofiber system of a bioadhesive polymer and basically use this as a medicated insertion tampon? So this is what Francis Bracco, who's a Guardian student over working with myself and Mohan on a Commonwealth scholarship, is working on. And he's doing really, really well. He's already published one paper in this area. And he's been looking at polymers such as polyacrylic acid and polyethylene oxide, and a range of others as well, carboxymethyl cellulose, to assess whether we can make these fibers in the first place with pressurized gyration, whether we can load progesterone into them, and whether they're effective at being bioadhesive. And the good news is the answer to all three questions appears to be yes. And here's some of his bioadhesion mixtures. He's developed a new method of assessing bioadhesion of fibers, because as far as we were able to ascertain, nobody's really tried to look at whether a fiber is bioadhesive or not, so we had to develop our own methodology. But again, his evidence seems to indicate that this does in principle work. And of course, these are all materials that are generally regarded as safe. So we think that this project is going in a very positive and encouraging direction. Okay, so that's enough about fibers. I'd like to move on to another area, which is microbubbles. And again, I'd like to pretend to you that we got into this area through careful planning, consideration of the literature, and inspired thinking. But the reality of the situation is we got into this area by complete and utter accident. But there is another sort of scientific moral here about the value of collaboration that I'd like to share with you as well. But basically, there's a long-standing interest, not necessarily in pharmacy, but in the imaging fields, for example, in the use of bubbles. And they're particularly used for diagnostics, because bubbles are echogenic. actually be able to see it on an ultrasound. And so it's used a lot for diagnostic purposes, but increasingly people are starting to look at whether you can use these for delivery purposes. So applications include food industry. So a lot of the cheap ice cream that you eat is largely air because it's very, very aerated. So the food industry like it because selling air makes a lot of economic sense. Also, people are starting to look at it in terms of drug delivery, and people will be looking at it for cancer therapies. And we have an interest with another student, Mari Pagnanov, who's looking at whether we can use this to treat esophageal cancer, which is very, very difficult to treat, by creating bubbles and then using sonication to burst the bubbles deliberately over the area of the tumour. People have looked at gene delivery, and also people have looked at things like cardiac drug delivery. So it's not a huge field for delivery, but it's definitely there and it's definitely growing. And so basically the phenomenon that we noticed with the pressurized gyration, which was completely unexpected, was that when Bahija was trying to make protein-loaded fibers, she was using the polymer polyvinyl alcohol, PVA, what she noticed was that she got what she wanted when she had about 8% lysozyme, which was the model protein that we used, and the 10%. But bizarrely, at low concentrations of protein, she got these bubble structures. So she was going to chuck the whole thing away and just concentrate on these two, but she mentioned it to Mohan, who automatically started metaphorically jumping up and down and saying, you've made bubbles in the pressurized gyration. That is really, really significant. Because making these bubbles is actually very difficult. It's a multi-step process. And what you've done is you've accidentally found a way of making them just bunging in your solution, spinning it, and out come your bubbles. So he got really rather excited. I was not convinced at all. But because he's an extremely good scientist and knows his field, I went along with him. And so he encouraged Bahija and his own postdoc to really start digging into this. So Bahija's done quite a lot of work, so she's looked at other proteins and found the same thing. So it seems to be a general phenomenon, and his engineering postdoc has been looking at the modeling, which I'm not going to go into here. And also Bahija's been looking at using atomic force microscopy with some quite elegant experiments to actually measure the bubble dimensions and the architecture as well. So we've done quite a lot of work on this now. And the other thing is that bubbles obviously are unstable, but you can stabilize them. Because what you do is you put gold nanoparticles on the outside. And what happens is that the way a bubble normally bursts is that the gas leaks out slowly, so the whole thing shrinks to nothingness. But if you've got gold nanoparticles on the outside, because they're hard, there's nowhere for them to go. So they act, if you like, as a kind of steering hindrance to the bubble shrinking. So, and also that's got spectroscopic advantages as well, because it means that you can now detect your bubbles using a variety of spectroscopic methods. So, I can't take the credit for spotting the significance of this. That has to go to Mohan, and it was Bahija that had the good sense to mention. So anybody doing a PhD or about to do a PhD, if you see something unusual, don't hide it from your supervisor, tell them. Because actually, it does actually have quite significant. But just to show how wrong I was, we ended up having it. I mean, Mohan said we should publish this, and I was saying, we can't publish this. This is an accidental discovery, and it ended up on the cover of Landia. And it's now quite a sort of major part of our collaboration. So I'm not saying this to illustrate how wonderful I am. I'm saying it to illustrate how wrong I was. But also, when you've got a good collaborator, they can see the significance of findings that you don't necessarily appreciate. Okay, so staying with the idea more of particulates, I'd like to move on to the work that we're doing on nanoparticles, and in particular the work that we're doing with Katma Gomez-Pina on trilayer nanoparticles, and again this is in collaboration with Mohan. The idea here is really to target pancreatic cancer. Now, if we compare prostate cancer to pancreatic, the one I draw your attention to is the survival rates. Prostate cancer, you have 81% now surviving five or more years if reasonable medical assistance is available. Pancreatic cancer is 4%, and that hasn't changed in decades. Basically, it's one of our big failure stories. Now, there is a very, very cynical theory that in order for a cancer to go up the priority list, somebody famous has to die from it. And basically, Francis Mitterrand died of prostate cancer, and immediately after that, in Europe at least, there was suddenly a lot of funding available for the study of prostate cancer. Now, that may be horribly cynical, but basically this 4% is shockingly low. But there are physiological reasons for that, and it's not just because people haven't been trying, it's also because it's actually a very, very difficult cancer to treat for a variety of reasons. There's poor delivery to the tumour site in the pancreas. It's very hard to get drugs to the pancreas. And also, there's a lot of resistance as well to the drugs that we are able to administer in terms of their effectiveness. So really, we're not in a good place at all for the treatment of pancreatic cancer. Now, the first line therapy that's typically used for this condition is gemcitabine. This is a nucleic acid derivative, as you can see here. But the problem is that although it's effective in theory, the reality is that there's a high resistance in tumours. And the mechanism for that resistance isn't fully understood. It's to do with nucleoside metabolism enzymes, possibly transcriptional factors, routes of delivery into the cell nucleus. But one of the things that you can do is that now you can code siRNA, silencing RNA, to a wide variety of protein expression. And basically, to cut a very long story short, these are fragments of nucleic acids. And essentially what they can do is they can prevent certain proteins from being generated within the cell. And so what that means is that you can actually code the siRNA to silence those genes which are going to produce the proteins which will then prevent the gemcitabine from being effective. And this goes back to what we were talking about yesterday about combination therapy. You put these two together, there's some evidence that basically you decrease the resistance to the gemcitabine and let the gemcitabine do its job. The problem that you've got is that siRNA, from a formulation point of view, is your worst nightmare. Basically, it's an unstable molecule. You have to complex it in something like chitosan. You need to have a completely and utterly different physical environment from the environment in which you have something like gemcitabine. So it presents a real difficulty, because even if this is going to work, just taking an injection of gemcitabine and an injection of siRNA, really it's a lottery as to where it's going to end up in the problem. So what if you could produce a nanoparticle which was so cleanly compartmentalized, you could actually put the gemcitabine and the siRNA in different regions? Now, you might be thinking, well, what's so great about this? Because we've had liposomes for ages, and they've got phospholipid and water in the middle, etc. True, but they have a lot of stability problems, and also they're not truly compartmentalized in the same way. You get some sort of partitioning of the molecules between those two. So what we want to do is to actually produce tri-layered nanoparticles, where we have an inner layer of PLGA, which will allow us to have sustained release. So if you put the gemcitabine in there, then at least in theory, that gemcitabine could actually be released over a long period of time and increase the chances of self-kill. Then what we would do is we would have an intermediate layer of chitosan. So you can automatically see, well, those of you that are familiar with this field, that you can't get a lot more difference than PLGA, which is a very hydrophobic polymer, and a chitosan gel in water, which is going to be positively charged and obviously very hydrophilic. And then to top it all, we would have an outer layer of PLGA, which would then act as a protective layer. So if we could at least manufacture this, then it presents some sort of interesting possibility of where it could go. And we haven't got this far, but once you've actually got your particle, then you can do things like you can pegylate it to prevent it being recognized by the immune system. You can put antibodies on in order to target it to specific cells. All that technology is available. It's not trivial, but it's available. So this is what the idea is. We'd have controlled release of the gemcitabine, we'd have a polyelectrolyte complex in the siRNA, and then we'd have this outer protective layer. Lovely, lovely dream if you can do it. Can you do it? That's a big question. Can you make something this sophisticated? So what we've been trying to do is to... Oh, sorry, and I also forgot to add, and you've got to be able to make lots and lots and lots of it. For all the reasons that we were talking about earlier, no point in doing this at a few milligrams per day or whatever. You've got to be able to make it on a feasible scale. So, again, working with Mohan, he's developed this four-needle system. Now, I know there are only three layers, but when you're making this type of sophisticated particle, you've got to have a fourth layer to basically stabilize it. I won't go into the engineering. But basically, this is the setup, so it's not dissimilar to a lot of the setups that I showed you at the beginning of the presentation. set this up into what's rather unattractively called tricky mode, or you can set it as a cone jet. Again, hopefully, this is going to work. Now, if you look carefully at this, what you can you see just a sort of shadow here? You can actually see the separate layers being formed within the particle, which is actually quite nice. And so I'll just show you the completeness. I'll show you the cone jet, so if you're curious. This is what happens if you change, so if you change the parameters such as concentration or the electric charge that is used across the tip, you can actually produce a fiber system instead. So the same setup will actually produce both types of material. So this is the basic approach that we've used, and it appears to be working reasonably well. We can certainly produce particles, and we can produce particles at a pretty high rate. With just that simple system, we are still talking about Millibrand scale, to be honest with you. But the point about it is theoretically scalable, and we have to take simple steps to developing this. Now, then you've got a really interesting question. Yeah, but how do you know with these tiny little particles what you've got? If you're saying you've got this very sophisticated architecture, how are you going to be able to verify that you've got it at all? So you can do things like TEM, and you can label various components within it. So you can put metals such as cisplatin, for example, into the DLGA as a model for the drug, because cisplatin shows up very hard in TEM. But the other thing that we've got at UCL, which is actually really good, and not in the School of Pharmacy, but within the university, is we've got some of the most sophisticated imaging techniques that you can find anywhere. So Fatima, being an extremely resourceful postdoc, started asking around and buying people copies, etc., etc. And she found this technique, better close to us, called super-resolution imaging with structural illumination microscopy. But basically what this is it's a very, very high-quality confocal microscopy. And those of you that are familiar with this technique will know that what it looks for is fluorescently active molecules, and it's able to image in three dimensions. This is able to do that to very, very high resolution. And basically what it does is it takes an object, so we put a sphere here, and it basically slices it up into different thicknesses through the system. So if what you then do is you take a fluorescently labeled cyRNA, which is easy to obtain, and put the fluorescently labeled cyRNA into your system, you should be able to see whether you've got the material that you want. So I hope to convince you, and we're going to hope to convince the referees in due course. So if you look at this now, what this is doing is going from the bottom effectively to the middle of the particle. And you can see the, it's on a loop, which is probably a little bit confusing. But hopefully you can see there that the, I'll show it to you just one more time because I'm talking while I should be silent. So what you see is you see the core, which is not fluorescently labeled, start to appear. At least I hope to convince you that's what you're looking at there. Okay. So in other words, you're seeing the fluorescently labelled cyRNA chitosan appearing around the material. So just in the last couple of minutes, I'd just like to finish with just giving a bit of a name check to some of the work that my colleagues are engaged with at the moment. So this is Soma, as everybody calls him, even his wife calls him Soma as well. And he's a very good nanotechnologist that's working in our institution. And what he's interested in is particularly inhalation technologies, but also chemically changing familiar molecules such as chitosan to give them properties which would be more suited to drug delivery applications. So in particular, what he's been doing is he's been attaching hydrophobic groups to chitosans. And you can heavily substitute and you can lightly substitute so that you actually end up with a low degree of hydrophobicity or a high degree. And basically this, I won't go through this in detail, but this is just an analytical work that he's been performing to actually assess the structure of his chitosan and indeed its solubility. So HCD refers to hydrophobic chitosan derivative. And basically what he's been doing is using nanospray drying to actually get very, very small and precise particles. And he then takes those nanoparticles and sprays them again in order to get particles which are of respirable fraction. Because basically, and again, apologies to drug delivery scientists in the audience who will know this, If you inhale particles, you've got to get them within a relatively narrow range of low microns in order for them to deposit in the lung. Too large and they impact on the throat, too small you simply exhale them out. So there's no point in inhaling nanoparticles if you exhale them out. And what he was able to do is he was able to make quite sophisticated surface morphologies, such as this crinkled shape as well, which he found actually had better aerodynamic performance and penetration into the lungs. And again, we have simulated deposition equipment, which will give you an idea of how these materials are likely to behave in the lung. And he was able to demonstrate that using rifampicin, you actually got a controlled release within a simulated lung environment using the highly hydrophobic derivative. But the thing I think is quite interesting is that if you actually have the low hydrophobicity, so in other words, you take chitosan and you put a smaller amount of hydrophobic alkane groups on there, the materials actually become surface active and they form micelles. So what he's looking at there is the possibility of using these to enhance the delivery of polysoluble drugs into the lung. And again, it's nice that it's chemistry meets engineering in that the architectures that you get for some of these particles are also very interesting. You can actually make them porous, which again can have advantages for very, very rapid release. And the final example I'd like to give you is again one of our stars, it's Ahmad Rahim, who used to work for the Institute of Women's Health and is now a phenomenally promising young lecturer with us. He's actually not in drug delivery at all, he's a neuroscientist, but he's got a huge interest in gene delivery, but particularly gene delivery to the uterus, which when he first proposed this, we were thinking, is that ever going to work? But I have to convince you that the evidence that he's producing is, yes, it does appear to do so. So he's got a particular interest, as have many of my colleagues, in rare diseases. And it's great that these diseases are now being looked at and being funded in a serious manner. And Gaucher's disease is particularly unpleasant disease, particularly type 2, whereby the life expectancy of the child is very, very low. Typical lifespan, you're doing well to get to 3 years, unfortunately. So is there any possibility for treating this condition in utero? Now, again, this is early days, but using adeno-associated viruses as the transmitter for the genes, what this shows is a survival map for an accepted mouse model for type 2 Gauchers. And what you can see here, days after birth, untreated, we're talking about 15. Treated seems to be going up to 130. So again, you see these wonderful experiments, and then, you know, the problems arise. So I'm not trying to sell this to you as we have just solved type 2 Gauchers disease. But it's fascinating that this is the direction of travel. So two sets of acknowledgements I'd like to give just at the end. One is for the various bodies, and because there's so much work, I've undoubtedly left off some, including those of my colleagues, who have very generously either collaborated with us or funded the work. But the other people I'd like to acknowledge is my research group, and as your dean will confirm to you, keeping your research going while you're also running an institution is pretty tough. And I'm blessed with a fantastically loyal and hardworking research group. I'd just like to highlight the people whose work I've been talking about. So this is Francis Bracco here, who did the biodiesel nanofibers work. This is Bahija Amy Abraham, who works on the pressurized gyration. This is Fatima Pina, who worked on the nanoparticles. This is Stefania, who you met earlier on. And I think there's probably one on the that I should have been putting here, but I haven't. But anyway, yeah, no, I think I've covered everybody. So thank you very much indeed for your attention.
Thank you very much, Professor Gray, for the informative lecture. And I call on Dr. Abu Bakr Osman to initiate the session.
I have two questions. One is to Ramar, it's very specific. The first question is that during the talk you have presented, ketoprofen noted about nanofibers. And you attribute the different release, the sequential release of the outer surface to the inner surface. How can we guarantee that this is the attribute to the release of this data? Does this mean that the old series is still valid? dilution release. It's a geometric system, and the release is diffusion control. And this is here, complete disrupt, the second area cannot pass.